coming, and I'm very pleased to be here to report on the findings from this two-year EU Department of Justice funded project. I think a sort of headline really is that we want to argue that Europe needs to do better in countering anti-Muslim narratives. And what I think we've been able to establish, and is I think well established, is the depth and complexity of contemporary forms of Islamophobia across Europe. But I think what's less well known, what's less well argued, is the challenge to Islamophobia. How can we put together a set of powerful, strong, unequivocal, inclusive messages that are able to directly engage with Islamophobic narratives and make a robust challenge? So what we, I think, want to argue is, like I say, Europe needs to do better not only in the fight to challenge Islamophobia, but it needs to deploy stronger, more systematic and more coherent messages to challenge that dominant narrative. And what we've found in our project is there's a lot of really dynamic, creative, innovative work going on across Europe and across the our member states. So what we've done with our project, I'll just introduce, I think, what is the most important finding, and then ask the country teams, as you'll be hearing in more detail, about particular contexts and situations. So we've done two things. We've firstly identified the most significant, most powerful Islamophobic narratives at work and categorised those. So we've identified a top 10 set of anti-Muslim hate messages. And secondly, what we've done is to identify the counter-narratives, the top 10 most powerful, most effective, we think, forms of counter-narrative that can be used. Clearly they're interconnected and a complex set of messages, but we've distilled them into 10 categories. And as I say, they'll be elaborated more by my colleagues. And what I'd like to do is just to take you through those 10 narratives very briefly. The first one, of course, is the question of responding to notions of Muslim threat. So our first and most significant narrative is one that is finding ways to challenge and contextualize constructions of Muslim threat. So finding ways to reject the sweeping associations of Islam and Muslims with violence has been elaborated in many ways across our different projects. And the counter-narrative that Muslims are not dangerous for local societies is one that has also been a part of that key message. And our second narrative is about what we call building inclusive nations, but that is really involves three specific threads. Looking at the reconstruction of narratives of the nation, exposing and challenging forms of racial and religious discrimination in substantive contexts, and developing actions to improve the safety and security of Muslim communities. So three threads there to that second message about challenging exclusive and discriminatory national projects and building inclusive nations. And our third counter-narrative is about cultural compatibility and conviviality. In other words, laying out arguments which challenge the essentialized separation of Muslim groups and narratives of the threatening Islamization of Europe, and asserting the culture of compatibility of Islam with European democracy and citizenship. And also, we give a lot of different examples about ways in which we need to emphasise conviviality, the ordinariness of everyday interactions and relations between Muslim and non-Muslim people in a whole variety of different social contexts. The fourth narrative is about elaborating plurality. So here, it's trying to move away from arguments that are lumping Muslims together, finding ways to articulate the variety and diversity of Muslim constituencies, hearing a range of different counter-narratives to that homogeneous account of Muslimness. Fifthly, challenging narratives of sexism and a number of ways that this has been talked about is looking at the long history, for example, of Muslim women in political and cultural spheres, promoting knowledge of Muslim feminists and engaging in those debates. And there are a number of ways in which, for example, developing positive and diverse narratives by Muslim women in safe spaces is one way in which that has been done. Next, it's a wider counter-narrative but has important precision in terms of challenging Islamophobia, and this is one that we've called Building Inclusive Futures. So that's about putting together arguments that are forward-looking, future-orientated, which go beyond the constraints of oppositional countering to construct an account of open, inclusive societies and provide complex and valid explanations for key issues. So here, looking at aspects of citizenship and the inclusion of Muslims into citizenship as part of an ongoing project of trying to move beyond a simple countering of anti-Muslim hate messages to present a new agenda and platform of arguments and positions. Seventh, we've talked about deracializing the state, so it's challenging institutional state narratives. We were talking earlier in our press conference about the Hungarian context and the importance of developing, of course, particularly in civil society in that context, arguments, examples, and interventions that are able to counter state forms of Islamophobic policy and rhetoric. Eighth is about humanity, emphasizing humanity and Muslim normalization. So finding ways to challenge narratives of division, stigmatization, and domination. And our field work identified a multiplicity of creative ways in which that objective could be narrated or represented and promoted across a whole range of different types of activity. So emphasizing humanity. And our ninth counter-narrative that we identify is building Muslim spaces and autonomy, building spaces for Muslims to take some narrative control. And this might mean, obviously, in terms of political space, but also in terms of art spaces and alternative media and other forms of narration and representation. And lastly, counter-narrative 10, thinking about challenging distorted representation in the media, social media, and in other contexts, with a claim to a progressive realism, a fit with the truth. Obviously, the real is always not easily known and is contested, but one way in which we can do that is also to increase the range and variety of Muslim voices that we hear. And our case studies documented a whole set of ways and claims for extending the range of Muslim voices. So our narrative, set of counter-narratives are interrelated, but they clearly categorise the varied and complex ways in which challenges to Islamophobia are happening today and happening across the EU. And I go back to my primary message, which is the need to develop and argue for a coherent challenge to Islamophobia by bringing together those messages in a coherent platform. Thank you very much.